There is no doubt that the 16-35mm and other wide-angle zoom lenses are the most popular for landscape photography. In this video, I will share 5 steps on how you can make powerful photos with your wide-angle lens. These 5 steps can sound very formulaic, but there should be plenty of room for you to mix up your compositions. And of course, there are other ways to make powerful landscape photos. This is just one, but very popular way. So without further ado, let's get started. The first step is to learn holistic thinking. There are 2 approaches to this term. The first is to zoom out and see the entire photo as a whole. And the other is the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. What I mean by this is fairly simple. The entire photo has to make sense. Don't include elements that does not benefit the photo. The individual parts doesn't have to be the most interesting stuff on planet Earth, but by adding them together, they should work and benefit each other. Just like puzzle pieces added together makes a picture, which is of course greater than the sum of the individual parts of each puzzle piece. It is important to remember that a wide angle lens obviously is very, very, very wide. Because of this, you have to be extra aware of your surroundings and what you include in the photo. In this first example from Stuxnes in Iceland, I have the mountains in the back and I have the wave in front. The wave in itself is not interesting at all, but it benefits the photo dramatically by making a strong leading line leading the eye to the mountains. In this photo from Seljalandsfoss, also in Iceland, I photographed it wider than I usually do. I wanted to include the dark clouds as they help drawing focus to the bright waterfall and emphasize the beautiful afternoon light. The stream in the middle works as a leading dark line among the bright grass. And in this example from an ice cave, we had the guide posing for us as to give a sense of scale. I used the stream in the foreground for the same reason as above to lead the eye into the frame. The tree in this example is a fine tree, but in itself it's not particularly interesting. But when we introduce the lavender fields, everything just comes together brilliantly. Step 2 is to find an interesting focal point. The focal point is your point of interest. It is what you are taking a photo of. That thing have to be interesting. Why else would you take a photo of it? What's interesting is obviously subjective, but I personally go with a few rules of thumb. Natural features which stand out in the landscape or buildings of cultural or historical value such as castles or churches all works great. Generally think of landmarks that pique your interest. Let's start with an example from the iconic Mount Matterhorn on the border between Switzerland and Italy. I wanted to photograph this mountain because it has this characteristic shape. It makes for an interesting focal point because it's recognizable and thereby relatable, it's unique and it stands out from the surrounding mountains. Your eyes can't help but being attracted to it. At 35mm, this photo is in the long end of the 16-35mm lens. If we go to the wide end, this example from the Black Church in Iceland makes for a strong focal point. We can all recognize a church. Some people apply a lot of value to churches. This one in particular is unique both because of its color and that it stands out in the relatively flat landscape. In this photo from Tintern Abbey in Wales, it's obviously the abbey which is the focal point. The abbey is a strong historical landmark that most people recognize. In this example from Aldeyafoss, also in Iceland, our eyes instantly goes to the center of the concentric circles and continue up the waterfall. Beside the waterfall being a landmark, we are drawn to patterns like these circles, which more or less works like a bullseye. The scene is also aesthetically pleasing because of the symmetry. You can mirror one side of the photo and get more or less the same photo. Here we have a really wide shot of the geyser Strokkur in Iceland. A unique and interesting landmark in itself. The focal point can also be a person. There are different reasons to put people in your photos. In this case, I wanted this exploring adventure feeling and story. People generally take up a lot of attention and you'll have to be aware if your photo is about the person or the landscape. In this photo from the old town of Strasbourg, we have this restaurant that stands out among the other buildings because it is lit. So it doesn't necessarily have to be natural features that stands out. It can also be buildings. However, this is probably more categorized as cityscape or travel photography than landscape photography. This also goes to show, no matter the kind of photography you do, the basic principles are the same. You can also find something very exotic or rare that most people are not used to see. The ice beach, or the diamond beach in Iceland, has exactly that. Although some would argue it's photographed to death, it's still a fairly rare sight to most people outside the landscape photography community to see these huge, beautiful chunks of ice on a black sand beach. When you know what to photograph, the question is how you're going to photograph it. With the wide-angle lens, you can include the surroundings and make a dramatic composition that really draw in the viewer. If your focal point is in the background, find a foreground that benefits the focal point. That last point is important. The foreground has to benefit the focal point. It has to help tell the story, give an impression of the location, help the viewer, push an idea or pull focus towards your focal point. I mentioned in my 7 easy tips I wish I knew when I started out in photography video that you shouldn't include a foreground just to include a foreground. It has to make sense. There are many reasons to do it, but photograph with intention. Don't show some boring random stone unless it makes sense to include it. In this example from Fairy Pools in Scotland, I have the stream in the immediate foreground working as a leading line leading the viewer up through the photo to the waterfall and onto the mountain, which is the main focal point of the photo. You can also see a triangle and leading lines in the clouds, which mirror the mountain. To draw back to the first step, the entire photo makes sense. On the island of Kalsoy in the Faroe Islands, you will find one of the most awe-inspiring locations to photograph in the entire world. On this workshop, we spent about 5 hours here enduring all kinds of weather. I tried to find a unique composition, which can be pretty hard here as your compositional choices are fairly limited. Just next to the main vantage point, I found a foreground with leading lines of grass that I could use in the composition. The curve of the lines continue up through the rim of the mountain in the back. The line continues round the photo, comes back to the beginning and encircles the scene. This is also a great example of the foreground not being particularly interesting in itself, but combined with the focal point, the whole is greater than the sum of the elements. This photo from the Alps shows how leading elements can also be patterns. The flowers in the near foreground coming together to lead the eyes of the viewer towards the church being the focal point of the photo. What these examples have in common is also the dramatic depth. This is arguably where the powerfulness of the photo comes in. The wide-angle lens can create this dramatic depth, the kind of depth where the photo is almost puking the landscape out into the viewer's face. One way to obtain this depth is to get really close to your foreground. Another benefit of getting close is you leave out distractions as you fill up the frame with what's of interest. The distance to the foreground is of course relative to whatever benefits your photo, but don't be surprised if you hit the minimum focus distance of your lens. In this shot from the Faroe Islands, I had to get really, really close to the stone in the foreground. It was covered by this beautiful green fungus, which in combination with its shape reminded me of a small planet. The patterns lead the eyes into the island in the background and sunbeams. As you can maybe see on this limited phone photo, I had to reverse the central column of the tripod and get all the way down low, as the fungus part of the stone was only about 20 cm in diameter. If the foreground is bigger, you'll of course have to stand further back, as in this example, also from the Faroe Islands. Here the road works as a very strong foreground and visual element leading the eye down the valley and into the background where the island of culture works as a focal point being beautifully sidelit by the setting sun. I absolutely love how this photo turned out. another one from the Faroes. Here I also include a near foreground, but as you can see, it's fairly empty. I included it to frame the bottom of the photo to have the line from the edge of the rim move through the photo and into the characteristic mountain. From the far background in the upper right corner to the near foreground in the lower left corner, you will see an arch from where the strong triangular mountain emerge. The foreground obviously doesn't have to be in the bottom of the photo. In this photo from the Diamond Beach in Iceland, I found this characteristic chunk of ice. It was just possible to fit the camera tripod and big filters under it. In this way, I could use the underside of the ice to frame the photo using the lines of the ice and long exposed water to lead the eye into the focal point, the photographer in the background. Be warned, a photo like this comes with a huge risk to your camera, as the salt water waves will instantly kill it if they come into contact. In the Tintin Abbey photo, we arguably have the focal point in the foreground and have the Milky Way in the background support the photo by adding this ethereal nightly atmosphere. It's a very simple composition controlled by light and shadow. As I give several examples of in my first video on composition, the eye is attracted to high contrast areas. The contrast between the Abbey in the foreground and the light from the Milky Way in the background sucks your eyes towards the Abbey and first later moves up through the Milky Way and photo. The wide angle and ultra wide angle lenses also create a lot of distortion and elongate natural lines in the photos, making almost everything work as a leading line towards the background. When you visit this location in the Faroe Islands, it's not obvious the cliffs on the left have all these lines or visual flow into the scene. That is a direct effect of the distortion of the lens, which elongate the edges of the scene. You can see the same effect in the clouds. Same effect can be seen in this ice cave photo. Besides having the stream of water leading into the scene, the roof of the cave is also a bit stretched because of the distortion. This helps to create visual flow into the scene. You'll likely see the distortion effect in most of the examples in this video if you choose to watch it again. I would highly recommend watching my videos on composition, as I break down individual compositional tools way more than in this video. Summing up, to make powerful photos you will have to simplify them, which kinda sounds counterintuitive. Include only a few but very dominant elements that fills up the photo and doesn't leave space or room for confusion. Now that we have the composition, it's time to take the photo. The biggest technical struggle of these wide-angle photos with a foreground close to the camera is to get everything in focus. I recommend lowest possible ISO if possible and a variable shutter speed. The aperture depends on the scene, as that's the setting affecting your depth of field. The general recommendation is to try to get the photo as sharp as possible. Too open an aperture, the photo gets a little soft and you risk not having everything in focus, and too closed an aperture, you start to introduce diffraction, which also makes the photo soft. Usually the sweet spot of the lens is between f8 and f11, but don't be afraid of using the entire spectrum of aperture values if you need to. In this example with the fungus foreground, I couldn't get the entire photo in focus, even with an aperture of f22. It would also be very soft if I chose that aperture. As there were little to no movement in the photo, it's an obvious scene to focus stack. As I was very close to the foreground, I had to make 7 photos where I changed the plane of focus, even though I photographed at f11. As you don't want to move the camera when you focus stack, a tripod is a great help. Sometimes focus stacking is not an option, as there's a lot of movement in the scene. That was the case for this photo from the church in the Alps. There were a constant breeze moving the flowers around. Had I gone for focus stacking, the flowers wouldn't have aligned between the photos in the editing phase. The shutter speed wasn't an issue, as there were plenty of light, so I had to go with an aperture of f22, as that was my only option to get everything in focus in one photo. If there is a long distance between your camera and the foreground, like 2 meters or more, you don't need more than f5-6 to get everything in focus if you photograph at 16mm. If you're in doubt, you can always check with a depth of field calculator from an app like PhotoPills. You can't really get around the editing phase when you shoot RAW. Straight out of camera, RAW files are flat and boring. You, as a creator, is the one who brings the photo to life. How you edit your photo is entirely up to you. I personally like to enhance the elements of interest in my photos. Draw attention to whatever I want to show and either remove or hide what I don't want to show. There are many ways to do this and there are a lot of different tutorials for free on the internet. This photo from Iceland were fairly good straight out of camera. I've added some contrast to it, cleaned the clouds, added a bit more mist and especially enhanced the water streaks in the foreground. The waterfall in this photo also got some enhancements as I brightened it up. The clouds were darkened and I added a mild flare coming in from the right. Generally an increase of contrast by making local adjustments. I gave the Aleafoss photo more or less the same kind of editing, local adjustments and a flare from right to simulate the light and warrant the increased brightness in the shadow areas. In this example from earlier you can see how I've brightened the road and darkened some of the landscape as for it to stand out more. The foreground is about the road, which is why I've decided to put emphasis on that. In this focus photo from the Faroes, I first made the focus stack. I had to make a few workarounds to control the highlights in the background as they easily got clipped, which meant I had to blend in a darker exposure for the background and compensate for those shadows using luminosity masks. A rather complex edit. In the photo from Tintern Abbey, I photographed the Abbey and the Milky Way separately. Then I turned the Abbey photo into a night photo and blended them to get the final result. And don't even get me started on my time blending photo from Drunken Year. Here I blended different exposures from a period of about half an hour together to make the scene I had in mind. If you want to know how I made my Milky Way and time blend photo, I have tutorials for both of these photos for sale via the link in the description. Summing up, it's about emphasizing what you want to show, which can be done with colors, contrast and tones, and hide what you don't want to show, which can be done with less colors and contrast. So these were the 5 steps on how to make powerful 16-35mm or wider angle lens photos. It doesn't really matter. There should be plenty of room for you to make your own compositions within this framework. And to finish off this video, here are a bunch of my own personal favorite wide angle photos. In the next presentation, I will present more tips on how to take your wide-angle photos to the next level. Be sure to check out my other composition videos too, or my 70-200mm video, or my 7 tips video, or any other of my educational videos. There are a lot of useful information there too. So thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something. As always, I would highly appreciate both a like and a comment.